And I'm Mr. Jeroninio Almeida, Business and Management Services, please. Thank you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
So, I don't know why, probably it's my karma, but I always get stuck with the last talk before lunch or the talk after lunch, which makes it even more challenging. So I'm not going to preach from the Quran. I'm going to come amongst you. I'm going to make this very interactive because I think everybody's waiting for lunch, so I wouldn't want to put you to sleep.
Okay, Navi.
I'm going to break this into three parts. I'm going to ask them questions. I'm a big follower of Socrates, and Socrates says, I cannot teach anybody anything. I like what Father Antonin Souza said, that business is mission. I believe so. And I'm actually writing a book which is going to be published by Penguin. It's called Leading a Mission with the Power of a Dead Mouse, because the organization I founded about 7 years ago, when we started putting it together, we had a lot of people who offered us funding, but we said we don't want any funding because we're building a very idealistic organization. And if we take any funding, it will then dictate to us what to do. We're an activist organization. It's called iCONGO. It's the International Confederation of NGOs. And we take very hard stands and speak out against it. Yeah, we feel that that's our fundamental duty. I believe most of the people in this audience are Christians, and I'm sure most of you are devout church members. How many of you are church members? Great. Good. And I assume all of you know your Ten Commandments. Let's have a show of hands. You all know your Ten Commandments? Yes? Okay. How many of you are citizens of India? Let's have a show of hands again.
Excuse me.
Great. How many of you know all your rights, your fundamental rights?
Thank you.
How can a democracy work when we don't even know our rights? I thought most people know their rights. At least in Delhi, most people know their rights. They don't really know their rights because they think what are rights are actually not rights. They know some part of the rights. So you know your rights, sir. Can you tell us one fundamental right which the Constitution gives you? Freedom of speech and expression is not really a right. Okay. It's part of it. Yes, it's a part of the right. Okay. So there are rights now. How many of you know about the new rights which have come in enforced in the past 5 years? Sorry? RTI. How many of you use RTI? None of you use RTI. You're wondering, why is this guy talking about all this? How is it important to power of teams? Isn't the country a team? How can the country work when you don't even know what your rights are? We don't know how to use RTI, which is a tool given to you by the government, which belongs to you. But instead of using RTI, you would rather pay a bribe and get the work done. Right? Okay, we don't know our rights. How many of you know that this constitution gives you something called fundamental duty? That you have fundamental duties? Duties. The constitution came into force on 26/11/1949. Our founding fathers, unfortunately, did not build duties at that time. They only gave rights. Right? 1976, in the Fourth Amendment, is when 10 duties, like the 10 commandments, were added to the Constitution. It's not enforced, but it says that to enjoy your rights, you must fulfill your duties. Now let's tie this to our vision and a strategy of our organization. How can you build teams if people have not bought into the vision and strategy? That's my question. That's what Father Antonin de Souza also said. And it's going to sound similar, but I come from the same school of thought. So I'm basically a leadership trainer. I train in a lot of companies. And I don't train in a lot of companies because I feel that I can't do anything over there, because the CEO's brief is, put some passion into my team. I'm like, okay, so how do I put that passion into it? Like, let's take them out for a time in the evening to a pub, and they'll be passionate for that evening. Right? So most of the people think that, you know, team building exercises are about taking people to an adventure trek, doing a lot of grappling and stuff like that, or whitewater rafting. And the guys are charged up for 3 days, and they think they've built teams. And I'm like, it's like taking a monkey to a L'Oreal salon and thinking that the monkey will come out looking like I show you a lie. Well, she wasn't. Right? Makes sense? Doesn't make sense. How can you build a team like that? But that's the entire concept of leadership training today. And most people buy into this because it's well sold. And they don't like people like me because I say that's not the whole concept of building teams. Because build teams, like all that, so I said again, you need to involve them in the process of creating that strategy and that vision. Failing which, you're forcing your thoughts on them. Does it make sense? Is it making sense? If it's not making sense, please let me show. Right? So let me show you a video. We do something called the Karmaveer Award. We've been doing it for the past 6 years. Happy to say that we built a very egalitarian platform where the princess of Switzerland, a slum worker from Calcutta, and a sex worker from Kamatipura have got an award on the same platform. Not because of who they are, but because of what they do for making a difference in society. We give these awards every year. They're positioned as the Global Awards for Social Justice and Citizen Action. Because we feel that every citizen needs to fulfill her or his duties, failing which, they really have no right to their rights. Right? That's my belief. We'll play video number one, please. Look at the stories. These are hardcore entrepreneurs from the grassroots. Can I have the lights on, please?
How many MBAs could do that?
How many leaders would do? Build it on a whole steel. Built it with the 300 to 400 people that she's got. And you know how she's built the team? She's built the team person by person. She's brought in people from the community to work as paramedics. She's gotten people from the community to work as nurses. She's educated a son and daughter and made them into doctors. She's educated a son and daughter and made them into doctors. And today they actually kind of work there as doctors. Work there as doctors, they're not the owners. The hospital belongs to the community. It's not even the Subhash University. That's a leader. That's a leader. And she's built teams effectively without any MBA from any Ivy League school or IIT. That's Subhash University. I love women, so I'm going to talk about women only. The other woman I'm going to talk about is Tulsi Munda. Tulsi Munda has built a school which now educates 25,000 children. No funding. Started building a school brick by brick by selling puff tracks. That's an entrepreneur. Do you agree? Do you agree that this is remarkable entrepreneurship? Right? So how do these people do it? I mean, they have no fancy MBAs. They have no fancy management consultants coming and telling them how to build teams by taking them out rafting. How do they do it? They did it because they made people feel included in the entire vision and strategy. They made it because they made people feel included in the mission. And this is a collective mission, this is a common cause. And I think that's what goes into building teams. I'm going to show you another video now. We all love Bollywood, I'm sure. I'm going to show you a small clip from a movie. So a movie called Three Idiots. And this will probably tell you what is required as values, as common shared values, for teams to come together and to perform. And then I'll ask you, what are those values? So watch the video, you know, very carefully.
Raju, welcome on.
Think out of the box, because these are the so-called three idiots. who actually go out there and do something because they want to not just be different for the sake of being different, but they want to say that let's take a risk by being different. Let's take a risk by being politically incorrect. Let's take a risk by being like this. Let's have the integrity and courage of conviction to do what we want to do. And I think if you promote that culture within your organization, you would build powerful teams. I'm going to sum up with this. I was told to cut short of my time, so I'm going to sum up some thoughts. You have a PowerPoint, please. There are nearly 20 people present. This is my thought. Because each person as they see wants them, each person as they want to be seen, and each person as they really are, plus each of them with their multiple resourcefulness. You know? If we challenge ourselves to think out of the box, if we challenge ourselves to come up with solutions in the face of adversity, in the face of problems, we will be amazed what the human mind can come up with. It's all about resourcefulness. It's not about human resources, it's about the resourcefulness. Next slide, please. Teamwork, this is a quote by Andrew Carnegie. Teamwork is the ability to work together towards a common vision. The ability to direct individual accomplishments towards organizational objectives. It is the fuel that allows common people to attain uncommon results. Next slide, please. The achievements of an organization are the results of the combined effort of each individual. It's a quote by Winston Kumar. Next. When your team is winning, be ready to be tough because winning can make you soft. On the other hand, when your team is losing, stick by them. Keep believing. Every boss only wants targets. We never want to invest in people. We treat them like cattle. I'll give you my favorite example. ICICI, when they train people to work for BPOs who are going to kind of cater or serve our Gola masters. So these are people sitting in India with anglicized names who serve people in the UK and the US. They are trained for minimum 6 months on the floor. Until they are ready, they are not put into a cubicle where they can start serving the Gola masters. Right? The iCONGO, as I call it, right? But the same ICICI for people serving the Indian market will pay them for 2 days. And you must, I'm sure you're going to call from ICICI saying, "Sir, do you want a credit card?" And you're like, you know, get out of my face. I don't want to talk to you. But the same person who's paying for the UK and the US, because the consumer over there is different, will be paying for us. Or should I call you later? Why? Because we've taken Indians for granted. Taken people for granted. And we don't want to invest in people because we've taken them for granted. But in the UK, there is a certain process. So we have to follow that process. Because we have to invest in people. That culture is not coming to India. So please bring that culture into your company. Next slide. A group becomes a team when all members are sure enough of themselves and their contributions, praise the skill of others. How many times do we praise the skill of others? We're always trying to create competition and run the other person down. Go to any workplace, whether it's a BPO or a big MNC corporate. There's the boss who likes to trigger the competition because he thinks that's the way management is. That guy has no clue what leadership is. There's a dumb manager. When we're doing leadership training, I won't name companies of being politically correct, but I'm amazed that where do these guys come from? They come from all coming up from the woodwork and their idea of a leader is my boss. And I think, your boss is your leader? Don't you have any idealistic leaders? This is what I get mostly. I'm not a senior manager. You know, my boss is my leader. The concept is you are the leader. Everybody is a leader. Even the intern, some intern would be a leader in a situation, but we don't promote that culture. So please promote that culture. Next slide, please. If you are all determined to play the first violin, we should never have an ensemble. Therefore, respect every musician in this province. Last year, we gave the Karmaveer Award to a Goan musician whose name is Anthony Gonzalez. I'm sure that you've heard the name. My name is Anthony Gonzalez. So, Sir Anthony Gonzalez is now 86 years old, never been awarded till last year. We gave him the Karmaveer Award because Sir Anthony Gonzalez is not only a musician par excellence, he's also a teacher par excellence. He should make people stand in the sun with the violin to Because she said that if we don't have that posture, we'll never be able to play the violin. And Lakshmikant Pyarelal, who is prodigies, actually made that song as a tribute to him. But Bollywood earlier used to be a little kind of communal in terms of not recognizing people who are Muslims or Catholics, and so I think Gonzalez never got the due respect in his sons. So he came to Karmaveer last year for the first time, and then he got the Dasaheb Phalke Award in 2011. So there are people like that in the Christian community who are equivalent exemplary work. Follow those as role models, follow those people as leaders. Next slide, please. Individual commitment to a group effort. That is what makes a team work. A company work, a society work, and a civilization. Like I asked, do you know your fundamental rights? You have Professor Google, please go on there and get to know your fundamental rights and duties. Because my whole concept of leadership is, it's not enough to be a good human and a good Christian. You need to be a good citizen, failing which you'll never be a good professional. Thank you.